Well, welcome. It is so good to see you this evening. How's everybody doing? Not too much rain today. We kind of dried out a little bit. It is so great to see you tonight. So thankful that you come to our last evening of the Titus Bible Conference. Thrilled, and we're going to kick off with our worship tonight. So may I invite you to stand to your feet, and we are going to lift up a song of praise to our God that he will open up the heavens. Come on down and be with us and stir and move. Y'all ready to join with us? Let's do it. One, two, three, four. Hey.
Breathing, but now shelter. I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven.
Come on now.
When I was broken, you were my healing. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future. My eyes are open. Cause when you call my name, I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day.
That's right.
Tell you folks have come to worship tonight, and isn't it great that death does not have the final say in the lives of those that have been surrendered to Jesus Christ? Aren't you thankful? Let's give him another praise. Give him another praise. Thank you. So with that thought, let's go ahead. Let's bow our heads, close our eyes. I'm going to read a verse of scripture to you. And no doubt, many of you, because it's Monday, you have fought that traffic, hustled to get here tonight, and I'm willing to bet that for the vast majority of us in here, had a crazy Monday, right? So now can be a time where we can just stop and be still and know that He is God. Listen, voice our concerns, our anxieties, our cares. We can repent of our sin, confess, make things right. So right where you're at, you just get alone with God. Be still. And I've got some great news for you out of 2 Corinthians I want to read to you. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 17 to the end. Paul said, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation, right? The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. And later down in that chapter, he says, therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ. Making his appeal through us is what Christ is doing. And so Paul implored the Corinthians on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. What a wonderful privilege, responsibility, but awesome adventure God has called us to. Amen. We're ambassadors for Christ. So far beyond the songs that we sing, when we leave the altar, go out that door into our culture, we are ambassadors for Christ. We have been reconciled, brought back into a right relationship with God because of the work of Jesus on the cross. Let's take a moment, all of us in here, let's give him thanks and ask him to show you afresh and anew what it means to be an ambassador for Christ. Oh, thank you, God, so much for hearing our prayer. Thank you for saving us and rescuing us, redeeming us, going to such a great length to demonstrate your love for us. We are a thankful people. We worship you. We ascribe great worth to you tonight. We lift you up with our songs, with our hearts, our prayers. We want you to be the name above all names, to elevate you to the highest spot. Forgive us in those times and those, even today, where we've put something else in a spot that belongs to you. Afresh and anew tonight, we realize we are ambassadors for Jesus Christ. Thank you for hearing our prayer. We love you. Thank you for being with us tonight. In Jesus' name, the church said, amen. Let's sing this great song about him being our Savior and our God. Sing with us.
I am not not skilled to understand what God has willed, what God has planned. I only know at His right hand stands one who is my Savior. I take Him at His word and deed. Christ died to save me, this I read. And in my heart I find a need of Him to be my Savior. That He would leave His place on high and come for sinful man to die. You count it strange, so once did I. Before I knew my Savior, my Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, He was, my God, He is, my God is always gonna be. Yes, living, dying, let me breathe. My strength, my solace from the strength that He who lives to be my King once died to be my Savior. One who is my Savior.
So thank you.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Thank you, Pastor Richie and choir. I tell you, thank y'all so much for how well that you've done this week, and thank you. And I'm so glad that you're here. I need to ask one question real quick. How many of you in this room are ministers or on staff, pastors or on staff at a church? I want you to stand. Would you do that for me? Look at these guys who are here tonight. Amen. Y'all look around. Give these guys thank y'all. Amen. Thank you for being here tonight. Thank you so much. We're glad that you're here. In a few moments, Dr. Marcus Merritt is going to come and pray for us, and this will be our offertory time and to give back and certainly to help with the expense of this conference. And Marcus Merritt is a great guy. Served on staff in Alabama with Alabama State Board of Missions there, and now works with our Georgia Baptist Mission Board, and he deals with church relations, pastor and church relations, does a wonderful job working for us. And in a moment, he's going to come and he's going to lead us in prayer. But before he does, John Drake is here. This is Stephen, our son, who's pastor at First Baptist Buford. John is Stephen's father-in-law, and John and I actually love each other. Amen, Brother John? And John was one of your students, is that right? And Bill Compton, my best friend, is here tonight, and he was one of your students. And they're still in ministry, amen. And so isn't that great? Thank you, guys. You know how much we love you, and we love you all. We want to thank you. Don Wilton is one of those gentlemen that when you meet, you just love. He's extremely humble. I spoke to him the other day on the phone. I said, Brother Don, what can we do for you? And he said, in his South African accent that I am not going to try to duplicate, he said, no, Pastor, what can I do for you? And he's my kind of guy. When I was over the preaching conference in the state of Georgia back in 2013, I had Brother Don come be the keynote speaker. A few years later, our son Stephen was over the preaching conference. If you remember, he had Rob to come, his son. Brother Don has two sons in the ministry, like Diane and I have. And he and his wife are blessed with a beautiful daughter who also is in ministry, serving with Samaritan's Purse, who we always support during the Christmas time. So he's a man that loves his fat wife and his family. He's been pastor of that First Baptist Church, Spartanburg, for over 25 years now. And so without saying anything else, I just want to say he's a spirit-filled man who loves the Lord Jesus, loves his family, loves his church, and I'm glad that he loves preachers too. Amen? And you're going to enjoy him tonight. But before he comes, Richie, could you give Brother Marcus a microphone and come here and pray? And let's make Marcus feel welcome. Amen? A dear friend. He's a tall, lean preaching machine. That's him right here. Lead us in a word of prayer.
Thank you, Pastor Tommy. Let me just say a lot of what I do around the state is working with broken churches, and I'm proud to say that you. Grace Baptist Church in Monroe is not broken. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we count it such a privilege and such an honor to worship you in spirit and in truth tonight in this place. Thank you for Pastor Tommy. Thank you for his vision, for his leadership, not only here at Grace Baptist Church in Monroe, Georgia, but also through the Georgia Baptist Convention. And Lord, we pray that you would continue to bless the staff and the leadership and the pews of this great church. And Father, I thank you for Dr. Wilton that will be coming to preach in just a few moments. Thank you for his leadership for so many years at First Baptist Church Spartanburg. Thank you, Father, for all of the many conferences that he's preached and spoken at over the years. But Lord, tonight we pray a very special blessing and a special anointing on Dr. Wilton. Father, we pray that you would just anoint him with the fresh oil of the Holy Spirit of God. Lord, you know that what we need in this nation is not more Republicans or more Democrats or more independents. We need more of you. Lord, we need a revival to change our nation and to change the heart of this country. And Father, tonight I pray that that revival, that nationwide revival, would begin right here in Monroe, Georgia. Lord, you said where even two or three are gathered together in your name, there you are in our midst. And Lord, tonight we confess that we're not satisfied with just you being in our presence. Lord, we want to be in your presence. Lord, we want to be Mary sitting at your feet. And Lord, I pray that tonight that truly we would hear from you. Lord, we would experience your presence and your power in a special and powerful way. Lord, if there happens to be someone here that doesn't have a relationship with you, I pray that before this night is over, that man, that woman, that boy, girl, Lord, would give their heart to you and would trust you to be their Lord and Savior. And Father, those of us that have known you for many years, I pray, Father, that tonight we would encounter you in a fresh way. Father, that we would experience your grace and your power in a new way, that our lives would be changed. Lord, that we would just be filled up with you, that we might be the kinds of disciple-making Christians that you want us to be. We love you, Lord. We give this service and this night into your hands, for it's in the name which is above every name, the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Changes everything, the turning point in history. Even now it's changing me from who I was. The story of my Savior calls me to the wonder of the cross. The gospel changes everything, and it is changing me. Yes, the gospel changes everything, the turning point in history. Even now it's changing me from who I was. My Savior calls me to the wonder of the cross. The gospel changes everything, and it is changing me. You saved my soul. Changes everything. There is no greater mystery that God would come to rescue me from who I was. The kindness of my Savior calls me to the wonder of His love. Changes everything, and it is changing me.
So you say,
you save my soul by your love, and I'm undone by your great love. You made a to you, my God.
To you, y'all, glory, honor, and praise. You have saved. redeemed us, rescued us. Let's celebrate. Amen.
Well, as the choir and the orchestra make their way down, what a wonderful joy it is to be in Monroe, Georgia. I tell you, I've just got to start out by telling you a little story here. When I first arrived in the United States 40 years ago, my wife and I ended up in a place called Columbia, Mississippi. I just wanted to say that because it'll help you to understand my Mississippi accent tonight. And I'm telling you, Brother Tommy, one of the first places we went to, and it shocked our system, was a place called Piggly Wiggly. And I cannot wait to get home tonight and tell my wife what they've done to Hoggly Woggly. This is absolutely amazing. This church is just magnificent. It is just too wonderful and amazing. And I just cannot express to you the joy that I have felt from the moment I got out of all that traffic, drove onto this parking lot. I'd heard about what God had done here, and to come and to walk in here and instantly sense the presence of God like this. Your pastor, Brother Tommy, has to be one of the most precious men I've ever been around. And I just love you, my brother, you and your dear wife, and for your family. And what an incredible joy and an honor to come and be able to stand here and preach the Word of God and to share with you and to meet so many of you and many of my brothers in the ministry who are here tonight and friends. And it's just great to be here. And I want to tell you tonight that I love each one of you and I thank God for you. And I have keenly anticipated this moment in time. And I know that the Lord is not about to bless us, he already begun. As Richie began to lead us in worship, and this choir, what incredible worship, the praise, the orchestra, the singing, the joy, just standing up there watching you. I enjoyed that as much as I did singing, just standing there watching you. You were into it. And if some of you weren't into it, you've got some good reasons. I don't think everyone who comes to church can smile all day, you know. And I mean that quite sincerely. I've never expected someone who's just lost a loved one to just break out in a smile, you know. I've always been very aware of that. I have a congregation. And we're a place where many people who come there hurt deeply. It's not a matter of just standing up and smiling. You know, things run deep, and that's why we gather like this together. It's not just about the outward, it's about what's inward. And Christ makes the difference, amen? And I want you to know that for me personally, it's an incredible joy to come and to be with you here, and I've looked forward to it, and I pray God's blessings upon each one of us. Now, I want you to know the Lord has put a word on my heart tonight that I want you to listen very carefully. We're going to be in the book of Acts and chapter 2 in chapter 3 in just a while. Acts chapter 3, but you will need to get your Bibles because I've got actually nothing much to say at all outside of God's word. I stumble and fumble around. I've got nothing of substance. I can tell some jolly good stories and things, you know, but that's about it. I don't have anything of real substance to offer anyone here tonight, but God does. And I want to just predicate what I'm about to share with you tonight. tonight by just saying this to you. Undoubtedly, you and I really love America. There's no question in my heart. I think the United States, I'm an adopted son for many decades. And I tell you, as I travel around the world, and I've had the privilege of preaching on every continent in the world and countries all over the world, and our television ministry is in over 175 countries around the world. You know, every time I'm somewhere, whether it's Asia or Africa or Australia, you come back to the United States, there's something very unique and special. It's the people. It's the beauty of the place in which we live. And you and I have been manifoldly blessed as a people. We've been blessed. For some reason, God has reached down and he's placed a hand of blessing upon this nation. And nothing that I'm saying to you right now would take away from that. But I'm going to say to you that as a Christian man, I'm a Christian man. I've given my heart and life to the Lord Jesus Christ. As a Christian man, I've got deep concerns about our nation. I've got deep concerns about my neighbors, about people down the road, people in the shopping malls of society. I've got deep concerns about the politics of where we are. Like some of you, I've had the opportunity to be in the Oval Office and to meet with people and rub shoulders and be in places that I would only at one time ever have dreamed about. I love the football and the fanfare and cheering for our teams and the rivers that flow down every highway and byway of the United States of America from sea to shining sea. But something's wrong. Something's wrong. So as a Christian man, I want God to speak to me. I want to know. I want to understand. You know, I have three grown children, and I've got eight grandchildren. I love them. And despite the fact that I love them so much, makes me even more concerned in a loving way that my children and my grandchildren, that they grow up to be men and women of God. And the very love that I have for my children, my grandchildren, and my wife Karen of 42 years, the very love, the deep love that we have is in fact that which motivates us. The Bible tells us this, that it's the love of God that constrains me. I'm not here tonight to mess around with you. When it comes to the deep things of God, I'm not here tonight to impress you with the profundity of word. I'm here to join with you in seeking God, because he's the answer to everything. You know, Brother Tommy leant over to me a moment ago and he said, you know, I just love that song that we're singing because it speaks so eloquently to my life and my family and the testimony of changed lives. I want to speak to you tonight about the action of God. And before I do, I'm going to say to you that there are three statements about God that all of us dare say here tonight would agree with. I have no doubt about that. If someone was to come to you tonight and say, "Tell me about God," what would you say to them? So if you'll beg my pardon, you and I can certainly arrive at the conclusion that if one is to talk about God, we can begin right there at the beginning, the book of Genesis, and we can go all the way through. I've been in my church where I am now for 25 years, and I love to open the Word of God on the Encouraging Word broadcast ministry that goes around the nation and so on. I love to get up in front of our people Sunday by Sunday and week by week. About 20 years ago, we began a Sunday night Bible study. And it's affectionately today, John, you'll love this. It's called Wilton 101. Throwback to my teaching days. But we started that. They packed that place out. And, you know, I just get a hold of the Word of God and open it. And one of the things I did some time ago, Brother Tommy, I decided to tackle the book of Revelation. You know, and I said, look, we're going to do a six-week study in the book of Revelation. And 9.5 years later, we closed it out. Took me 9.5 years to get through it. I mean, just so powerful. When I go, I lead groups to Israel every year. You know, I've been 27 times. And people will come with us, and I'll stand there in the battlefields of Armageddon. And we'll have more fun than you can imagine. And we're laughing and carrying on and enjoying ourselves and riding camels. And we'll open the Bible and I'll start teaching them and showing them how this is connected to this and what God did there, He does here. And we'll stand there where David and Goliath encountered the incredible presence of God. And I'll connect that into the battlefields of Armageddon. If I was to ask you today to tell me just one thing about God, what would you say? There's a lot of things. Love is a great place to start. I just want to offer three things. May I do that, Brother Tommy? Number one, that God is. Any further questions? Right? God is. You got a problem with that? We had a tragedy in our church a week or so ago. 25-year-old daughter of one of our families. Beautiful girl. Died tragically of a drug overdose. 25 years old. Beautiful girl, man. You know, her funeral a week ago, and I stood there, and there were probably, gosh, I don't know, 1,500 people at her funeral. And I got up in front of all those people, and I said, you know, what can we say in a time like this? As we love on one another and this precious family, I dare say if Brittany, who was lying in that casket right there in front of me, Brittany could actually stand here with me right now, what do you suppose she would say? I said, you know, I think the first thing Brittany would say is, there is a God. Don't mess with Him, man. God is. That probably is one of the most powerful theological statements we can make, because that's exactly who God is. By the way, most of you know that I'm Dr. Billy Graham's pastor and personal friend, and in fact, I'll have lunch with him tomorrow. I've been going to see him every week for years and years and years and years. One time we were sitting there having hamburgers together after one of the meetings and the phone calls that come in and all of the things that Dr. Billy Graham has been involved in all his life. And he looked at me and he said to me, you know, Don, I can't get over the fact that you cannot define God in terms of the word existence. I said, what do you mean by that, Dr. Graham? He said, well, God never existed. And I said to him, this is in a conversation, well, Mr. Graham explained that, and he said, how can anyone ever exist who always is. The word existence limits God. You cannot limit God. So here's number two about God. You ready for this? God is, number two, God acts. I'm going to read you the scriptures in just a minute. God acts. That little word there is a doing word. You could use another word, perhaps, you could, you know, to help us understand that word, but it means that God, who is actively engaged in his isness in our lives. I know, now can I speak a little Southern? I know that ain't good English. See, it never sounds the same when I say it. I've been trying for years and years. Right? God acts. God is acting. He's moving, revealing himself, showing himself. He's blessing. He's revealing, loving. All the attributes of God are the activity of his activeness. So here we've got two things. We're just making statements about God. Number one, that God is, God acts. If I may, if you'll beg my pardon. Number three, quickly. Number three, God invites. Everything God is through his action is designed to invite. And he has us in his sights. It's an incredible thing. So what I want to do tonight, very briefly, and I'm just going to do this very briefly tonight. I'm going to try and take you into God's word and show you this. Because when you understand this, as a believer, as a Christian man, a Christian lady, in a strange kind of way, you begin to see this world in which we live through God's eyes. You know, Brother Marcus, you made such a wonderful statement. I appreciate you, you know, because you've had such an incredible ministry. And I just love you for that. And, you know, Brother Marcus made a statement that he spends a lot of his time going around the state helping churches that are having issues and problems. He said, man, I'm so glad I'm in a church that is not doing that. It's not void of people. Someone told me one time the biggest challenge facing any church is the fact that it's filled with people. It's true, isn't it? Right? All the personalities. You know, have you ever noticed that a chair never gives you trouble in church? If it does, you just move it. But the issue remains that God intends for us, even at the point at which we will never get to the mystery of the Godhead, we cannot go beyond the point at which God does not permit us to go. But insofar as God will by his Spirit, I personally want to be able to see and to love and to minister and to share and to live as a Christian man, looking at my world through God's eyes and not through mine. Let me tell you what happens when you consider this world through man's eyes. You look like the United States Congress. Any further questions? Rest my case. Do you want me to tell you very quickly how to make this church, Grace Baptist Church, how to turn this church, make this church look like the United States Congress. Let me tell you how to do it. Do it just like that. Just one of you start getting up and behaving like a dipstick. I didn't say that. Brother Tommy told me to say that. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to look at this in two lights. I want to look first of all at Acts chapter 3. That's to lay the groundwork. Because in Acts chapter 3, we have recorded one of the most wonderful passages. You and I have studied that passage. When I go to Israel, I just got back a little while ago. I love going to this place and with our people and looking at this incredible encounter of this life-transforming event that took place in the life of this one man. This is really a picture of salvation. I'll try to read it and discipline myself not to stop, but just read perhaps the first 10 verses. This is what the Bible says. One day, Peter and John were going up to the temple at the time of prayer. It was about 3 p.m. Now, a man crippled from birth. There's your picture of all of us, born in sin. We are conceived in sin. Our Adamic nature, because of the sin of Adam, that's how we're born. We're born hopeless, helpless, can do nothing. We're lost, dead in our trespasses and sins. So he was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those going to the temple courts. I just want to say, I've got to say this, Brother Tommy, but the temple was the busiest concourse. You know, I drove here, it took me nearly 3 hours tonight, just coming from upstate of South Carolina down the I-85 corridor. I mean, it is getting busier and busier and busier. I know Atlanta, and that's not busy. I'm talking about up there. And it's just, it gets busier and busier and busier and busier. And at the temple courts was the corridor of the world, really, in many ways. You'll find that right there at Pentecost, you know, when Peter stood up and preached, people were coming in from all over the world. That's the beginning of the Great Commission. God brought the world right there to the steps of the southern steps of the temple. And Peter got up and preached Jesus, and people got saved and were baptized. Well, it's about to happen here again. Now, why would they have put this man there? Because this was the zone of greatest potential to meet his need. I mean, this man was lame from his mother's womb, so they plonked him right there in a place of high traffic where most people would come by, and people would probably drop in a quarter or whatever it is, a couple of dime, whatever it is from time to time, because this man couldn't fend for himself, he couldn't eat, he couldn't provide for himself, and so he was placed in the greatest traffic pattern. But he was about to discover something. You know what it is? You can get lost in the crowd and you can find yourself in the greatest place, in the greatest circumstances, among the greatest people, and never find hope for your soul. Maybe tonight you're looking at me and you're saying to me, you know, that's me. You know how many people run from God? They run from God by running into the crowd. One of the best ways to do is just go to a ball game and yell and scream your head off. Just get busy. I tell you, another way you can get lost and get away from God is just spend all your time trying to make money, trying to build a business, trying to do nothing wrong with any of these things. That's not a criminal act. But it's just an... We do everything we can to get away from the voice of God, to hide, to drown it out, to get away. Some people very sadly resort to things like alcohol and drugs, and they drown it and they hide it and they try to get away. There's a lot of different, there are 1,000 different ways. Well, this man was put in the middle of the crowd. Good reason. But he couldn't find ultimate help until something happened. Look what happened, verse 3. Bible says, when he saw Peter and John about to enter in, he asked them for money. I don't know, maybe he heard that they had just preached a series down at the First Baptist Church of Jerusalem and got a good love offering or something. Word had got out and maybe they would be generous. He heard something about it. Peter looked straight at him, as did John, and he said, look at us, not look at us as men, but look at us because we've got something to tell you. We've got a message. We've got something that represents life. So the man gave him his attention. I love this story, don't you? And then verse 6, then Peter said, silver and gold I do not have, but that which I do have I give to you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. What was that song Richie led us in? You know, stand up and storm out of the grave. I mean, this is exactly what it is right here. Taking him by the right hand, he helped him up, and instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong, and he jumped to his feet. He began to walk. Then he went with them into the temple courts, walking, jumping, praising God. And when all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the same man who used to sit begging at the temple gate called Beautiful, and they were filled with wonder and amazement at that which had happened to him. I call that the contagious effect of salvation. By the way, have you noticed when a person gives their heart to Jesus? I mean, they glow like a sunbeam. Some of us that have been it a long time, man, we dipped our wick in something. I know it doesn't happen here. I know that. I'm not talking about this church. But in my church, I got some men that have been Christians so long. You look out there, they're just like big, grumpy old people. Here's the issue. God is. If you would just allow me to, if I may just say it. This story here, God was smack there right in the middle of it. I mean, he was in the crowd. He was at the temple. He was right there on the sidewalk. God is. But the second thing is God acts. Number three, God invites. So let's just see what happens when God invites. Some of it is not what we would expect. So here's what happened. Let's go to chapter 4. All look at chapter 4. It's what the Bible says in chapter 4. Bible says that the priests, the captain of the temple, God, and the Sadducees came up to Peter and John while they were speaking to the people. They were greatly disturbed. I grew up on the King James version of the Bible. And I'm telling you, King James says they were just flat out angry. They were just mad. I mean, they were spitting mad. They were disturbed because the apostles were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. So they arrested Peter and John, and they put them in jail until the next day. And I love verse 4. Verse 4 has to rank as one of my favorite verses of all time. It says, but many who heard the message believed. And in this instant, the number of the men grew to about 5,000. I don't know how many times I've looked at Mr. Graham over the years and I've said to him, Dr. Graham, they had a Billy Graham crusade right here in the New Testament. You weren't the first one. I mean, I did, and I'm still living. I'm still standing here. By the way, some of you asked me about him. Mr. Graham is very frail, very, very frail. But I'll tell you, he is as precious a man as he has ever been. He's praying for us tonight. He knows I'm here. I have to give him a full report tomorrow. Every detail. Nothing makes him express more joy than to know that we are talking about Jesus together. And I'll be sure to give him your love back. A couple of things about this, which I think are so very, very important, because there were three reactions to God's invitation. The bottom line is God is, God acts, and God invites. When that man's life was changed, God sent out a living, practical invitation, a notice to all people. This is for you. And it's interesting in this passage that there were three reactions to the action of God. I'd like to just share them with you. You ready? Number one, when God acts, some people resort to silence. Some people just remain silent. Now you're going to say, now, Pastor, where do you get that from the text? I'm making an inference from the text. I'm a Bible preacher, make no apology for that. But every time Jesus spoke, the crowds gathered. I experienced the same thing. We all do. All of us. I think that's a very safe inference to make when it comes to the gospel. And certainly in the United States of America, country in which for generations the word of God has been proclaimed from one church after another, one hilltop after another. How many mothers have prayed for their sons and daughters? How many lives have been lived? How many acts of incredible works have been done in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ? How often has God, who is, acted and invited people to turn their hearts and lives? How many more times has God got to reveal himself and invite us as a people to come back to him? But some people, they see, they hear, just remain silent. Many years ago, perhaps when I was a lot younger, there was a group that popularized a song that was entitled, When Silence is Golden. Do you know that as far as God's concerned, silence is unacceptable to him? May I say something very lovingly? The greatest tragedy of silence is when it happens in the church. I have a beautiful congregation. I love them so much. We've got people in our church that are deeply embedded in my heart. Can't be somewhere for 25 years and not grow in love and understanding and friendship, and the list goes on. You know, I've still got, and I'm not picking on the men, but I do, because I'm one of them. Do you know I've got some men in my church? You're not going to believe this. I've got some men in my church. And I'll tell you, they can go to a Clemson football game. As I said, I know it doesn't happen in Georgia, but in where I live, they'll go to a game. They'll get there 5 hours before the game starts. They'll put on their clothes. They listen, in my town, they'll ride around with flags on their motor cars. They'll go, they'll get there long before me, buy all the chicken in the upstate before we get there. Tailgate, they'll be the center of life and activity. They'll sit in their favorite seat. They will buy everybody in the row hot dogs. They'll get up there with pom-poms, C-L-E-M-S-O-N. And I got a friend who's from Georgia, and he goes, woof, 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 woof. I'm in. I mean, we have the best fun, you know, it just goes on and on. But that same man will come to church on Sunday morning and we'll get up and sing about the blood of Jesus and about the Lord Jesus Christ. And that man will stand there with his arms folded, look like he's recovering from hookworm treatment. I I'm telling you, I'm telling you that. It happens. You want to be a preacher. You want to see what we look at. I love them just the same, you know. I mean, it's just this amazing thing. When it comes to responding to God. Now, can we make something very clear, folks? We don't measure responding to God by whether you clap or you don't clap, or whether you stand or whether you sit, or whether you smile. I just spoke about whether you smile or whether you don't smile, or whether you up and about and look like you got ants in your pants. Listen, that's not the measure. That's not what I'm suggesting. That's not the measure of your spirit. I'm talking about just stand up, man, and count for the Lord Jesus Christ. What seems to be your problem, brother? Look at America today. The silence is deafening. But you know, there was a second reaction. When God acts, some people become angry. It's one of those points. I don't like talking about this, but it's true. Look at America today, folks. It's true. You know, the hard part about this, I wish sometimes the Word of God has a way of really taking a chunk out of us, you know. Do you know the Bible actually identifies who these people are? Did you know that? Calls a spade a spade. So could I just share with you? So this is not me. Don't hold this against me. All right? So who were the people that got positively mad about the gospel? Who got really angry in the Bible? Who does the Bible want us to know? Number one, the clergy. The ministers, the pastors. That's what it says, the priests. I didn't say that. Can you see my Bible? I didn't make that up. It's my group. You know, I talking about Dr. Graham, I remember being in Scotland with him in 1990. And God was moving, and one day we found ourselves at Murrayfield Rugby Stadium. Some of you might remember and read the reports. One of the greatest outpourings ever. And I went with Mr. Graham to a press conference. And if you've ever traveled with Dr. Billy Graham over those years, I mean, the press went everywhere. I mean, BBC, German television, American television, Australian. They just followed him everywhere. And the Queen would be there, and the Prime Minister, and the Chancellor of the Exchequer. And I mean, it's just like everywhere we went. And we're sitting there, and there's just this mass of people and cameras everywhere. And I'm sitting right there with Mr. Graham, and one of the reporters looks up at him and says to him, "Dr. Graham, this is an interesting question I want to ask you, sir, but as you've been here in Scotland, this land in which, the land of John Knox, and where there's such a rich religious heritage, what has been your greatest difficulty? What has been the greatest opposition you've encountered?" Mr. Graham never hesitated. He looked up and he said, "The clergy." And there was stunned silence. I mean, that's a nice "how do you do," you know. Do you know in America today, do you know where most people want to go in order to find a just reason to sin the way they want to sin, do you know the number one place they'll go to is to a clergyman? Because if they can get a clergyman to agree with their sin and to say that the Bible is not current, it's not up to date, it's out of date, and God doesn't mind if you do that, and he'll get over it, and after all, God just loves all. If you can get a clergyman to agree, you got it made, son. You got it made. If you can go and become part of a church in which the church will agree with your sin, you've got it made. That's a church. The priests. You know, and some of you are looking at me right now and you're saying, oh, thank you, Lord. I'm so glad I'm not in the ministry, you know. I'm glad I'm not a preacher, you know. Well, the next one's for you. Can I share number two? Remember now, he's telling us who these people are. The next one is the captain of the temple. You know who the captain of the temple is? I didn't say this. I'm just passing along what Brother Tommy told me to say. Captain of the temple, chairman of deacons. No, I didn't. I didn't say that. You know, I'm not trying to get off track here, but I'm a very spoiled person because my father, wonderful pastor and preacher, you know, I grew up with just such a love relationship with deacons and people who led the church. And now, you know, I have 150 serving deacons in my church. And I'm going to tell you something staggering. The men who serve in my church, they are doctors and lawyers and candlestick makers and coaches and dads and granddads and retirees and plumbers and electricians, and they come from every walk of life. Do you know that in 24 years, I have never been in a deacon's meeting with 150 men where there has been one even suggested upset, wrong word, someone falling out of fellowship? I have never seen a man storm out of a meeting and say, well, I'm not going to play with you anymore because you don't do it like me. I have never been in that. I'm just so spoiled. And I'm just telling you, guys, but God warns us about it. All it takes is one dipstick. If you're here, would you please stand? No, I didn't say that. I did take that back. Captain of the temple. But there was a third group here, and that's the Sadducees. Brother John Bill, you know, talking about when I was professor preaching and evangelism and all those great days we had together. You know, I used to, listen, when I was formerly on faculty and I did quite a lot of that at a certain time in my life, and I still serve on boards all over the place, but, you know, back then, I wouldn't talk about Sadducees too much because that is the professional elite theologians. You know, in the scriptures, there were two sects. There were the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and we've all studied that, and we all know that. So who were the Sadducees? Well, we've got it written right here. They were the sect who did not believe in the resurrection. They did not believe that God raised Jesus from the dead. That's why they were sad, you see. We know that. Bible says, man, these people who had all this head knowledge, out of here, big boy. Bible says, man, this can come. You know, that's why I'm so grateful for people like Brother Tommy, who's a pastor and who has such love and passion in his heart. That's why I'm so grateful for those of you that serve in leadership in this church, in all the different capacities, because you love the Lord and you're responding to Him, you're reacting to Him. You're living it out for Him within the context of your own personality. Lending your giftedness, doing what God has called on you to do. You're making a difference. You take the time to put your hand on someone's shoulder. You're the first one who looks out here and someone walks in off the street here and you're the first one who goes up and says, hey, how are you, man? Just welcome this morning. And you think that means nothing? Listen, you can have all the programs in the entire universe. You have a welcoming, loving church. The people come. I rest my case. I thank God, man, for the godly seminary professors that I was around. People that taught me and who loved me, who had a heart, who had all kinds of knowledge, man. They could parse verbs and they could get into this and divide that, and they had a deep understanding. But, man, there was that incredible passion, you know. God did something here with this young man's life, transformed his life. Some people just stood around and said, really? Other people just got positively angry, but there was a third group that I'll close with tonight. Right there. When God acts, some people always are saved. By the way, you know, that little verse 4 there begins with the conjunction. Now, I did a couple of master's degrees in English literature and language, and I'm telling you, that little conjunction there, I mentioned that, you know, the King James Version, the word there is however. If you want to put it in another term, how be it. Can I put it another way? Contrary to public opinion. Put it another way. Despite the opposition. People get saved. I like that. I'm telling you, it's right there. I like that. And look what happened here. Howbeit, many of those that heard the word believed, and the number of them was about 5. I mean, God does things. I mean, you and I could swap stories tonight and share testimonies about God's amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was blind, but lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. You know, it's so amazing to me, because in my experience as a pastor, you know, preaching every week, I've found, man, when you preach the word of God, you tell people about Jesus, you can preach to the apples and the oranges get blessed. God does something. God's at work. And we're part of that. Where are you, Richie? Is he here? Come on up. Where are you? I heard a voice. Come up here, brother. All I heard was a voice. Was that God up there? who's playing the piano or whatever? Jessica, get up here quickly. Come on. Now, I'm going to tell you something, folks. Listen. We're going to sing a couple of verses of a hymn, song together. And Richie is just going to lead us. It's not about the song. Some of you are going to say, now, wait a minute, Brother Don. How can you be so happy at the invitation? I just told you why. not a big, this is not like some kind of secret thing that goes on. It's the happiest, most wonderful time. I don't have any stress when it comes to the invitation. I don't measure the success of any time Jesus is shared by the number of people who walk down an aisle or who raise their hands or how this happens or how many verses we sing. Or that's, folks, these are just all blessings. You know how we measure that? By the fact that God is, God acts, and God invites. And you know better. So right now, here's what I'm going to ask you to do. Number one, if you don't know Jesus tonight, I'm going to ask you to react. And I'm going to tell you, in this church, I should imagine that our beloved pastor just give the word. I mean, there are probably scores of people who would give anything right now to pray with you, to help you, because that's what's happened to us. Others were there for us. I'm telling you, there's a ladies and men, young people here in a heartbeat. We're here for you because Jesus has done that for us. And I'm going to ask you tonight that you would leave your seat, come down here. I'm telling you, someone will be with you in a heartbeat. You can turn to them and say, I've given my heart to Jesus. You can turn to them and say, man, I'd like to give my heart to Jesus. We'll take it from there. We'll show you what the Bible says. I'm telling you, the greatest decision you can ever make is to give your life to Christ. I did. Changed my life forever. I did that all the way in Africa, man, so far away from the United States, had no idea what God would do with me. God is an amazing God. Number two, I've got no doubt. Most people here tonight love the Lord. I know that. I'm not asking everyone to come down here. In fact, I don't want you to. Except, of course, if the God who is has acted and he's inviting you to. If God, it doesn't matter. Maybe God is inviting you to come forward and pray for your son. Do it, brother. Do it, sister. Maybe your best friend. Maybe your marriage. Maybe there's a burden. Maybe you're going through some illness. Maybe there's a diagnosis. Let me tell you something, folks. I believe in the power of prayer. I believe God will deliver. God is, God acts, God invites. So, in a great order to, just now, I've got to get in my car and head on, man. I've got meetings starting at 7 o'clock. I'm not going to stand around here and hug necks until 11 o'clock tonight. Forget that. See, folks, listen. This Christian life is real, man, isn't it? It's real. It's not a pretend. It's not a, for me to be here is joy. This gospel is joy. Let go, man. Let go. And if God has invited you, maybe tonight, maybe you haven't walked down the aisle in a long time. Maybe you just need to get up and get active. Maybe there's something that's been said or not said, but the Spirit of God has said it. And you need to do it. Do it, because I promise you, that's when you take hold of all that God has in store for you. And it's an incredible thing, guys. It's an incredible thing. And your pastor is our shepherd. He'll take us and lead us as God leads him. Strike up the band there, Jessica. Let's get it going. Let's do this together. You ready? You ready? This is the altar of God. This is his altar. So just come. Maybe you'd come and then just go back to your seat again. That's fine too. Let's stand together. You come tonight. Just as God leads you.
Without him I could do nothing. Without him I truly fail. like a ship without a sail. Jesus, oh Jesus, do you know him today? Do not turn.
Like your heart, your life tonight. You give your heart, you give your life to Christ. This is your time. You come while we sing. Come on.
Jesus, oh Jesus, do you know him today? Do not turn.
Heard the message tonight. You know, I don't come behind a preacher and preach it again, but I do need to remind you tonight that God's spoken to some of your hearts, and you need to act upon what God has said. There's some of you standing in this room that you know that you've been saved, and you may have been visiting our church. You know that you want to make this your church home. We'd like for you to do that. Every good Christian needs a good church, and every good church needs a good Christian. I want to encourage you tonight, if that's how you feel, and some of you even came and prayed, and some of you have started serving in our church, haven't yet made it your family or your home, as we call it. I want to give you that opportunity. Now, some of you came tonight, and there's some trouble in your life. You're struggling. Well, listen, you know how to turn that to the Lord. Just ask him to help you. If there's sin in your life, the Bible says if we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You know that. I'm going to get Brother Richie, and this can be our commitment for.